Prophecy headlines. The burdensome stone, which should be on a lot of people's minds, considering what's going on in the Middle East right now. But that prophecy will end at some point very soon. So, this is the prophecy headlines for 19 May 2021. As always, I throw up, you know, this slide to show you how close we are prophetically. You know, what needs to occur in the prophecy for Jesus Christ to rapture the church? Nothing else. What needs to occur to bring about that final period of time when the church ends, and that age of the church that started at Pentecost will end with the rapture of the church, and then we will proceed on into the next phase of your plan, which is that 7-year tribulation. All these things, milestones have been reached thus far. We'll discuss some of them tonight, focusing on Ezekiel 38 and 39 and how that folds into Zechariah 12, a powerful piece of prophecy. For we know we're inch stoning closer and closer and closer to that time of the end of the age, in which you shall come from the shadows of the history. And we know you're all there. The Christians all know you're there, but the world doesn't know you're there. But they will, on that day, acknowledge you as Lord. The Gentile nations will see for who you are. So, with that, we'll go further. Talk about the headlines of the day. The bloody conflict between Israel and the Gaza Islamists, who are the Iranian proxies, that continues. And there's no end in sight as of, you know, I checked at 4 o'clock. So it's still ongoing. Again, we discussed last week, Temple Mount is ground zero. Why? Because it is being struggled over between Satan and his forces and God and his plan for the redemption of mankind. But those prophecies we discussed last week, go back and look at them if you didn't. They're critical to our understanding of why this event occurred. But it was a rough week. We're in the 8th or 9th day, depending upon what part of the world you're in. I will read some of these towards the end. The IDF, that's Israeli Defense Force, announced earlier that 65 Hamas targets were hit in airstrikes overnight, as Netanyahu vowed to continue striking the terrorists. A total of 212 Palestinians have been killed in the Gaza Strip, including horrifically 61 children since last Monday. The IDF, Israeli Defense Force, says that figure includes 120 members of Hamas and 25 members of the Palestinian Islamic Jihad. And 10 Israeli civilians have died, including a child, and they've been killed by the rocket attacks. Now, I will point out here that Israel is not targeting children. What is happening instead is Hamas and the Palestinian Islamic Jihad are placing children in the areas where they have their military outposts, where they have their rocket sites, where they have their headquarters. They are literally sacrificing their children for headlines. Now, what that reminded me of is if you go back into this land of Canaan, you will know that they sacrificed their children to Moloch when they were babies, so they would be blessed and have what they want in their future. And I see that evil being perpetrated today in this similar event. Israel is doing all it can to warn them in advance they're going to blow these buildings up. But still, they put their children at those locations. So it's just absolutely disgusting. The Palestinians, or I should call them the Gaza Islamists, are pushing the holy sites again because those are triggers to the Muslim people. They're triggers to trigger the emotion, to get them fired up and anti-Israel sentiment to be driven among them. So that's why the holy places are being used, so the El Aqsa Mosque and the Temple of the Dome, are riots are intentionally portrayed there so they will provide excellent videos to go throughout the Muslim world. So this is a campaign of not just battles, but of thought. Here's another graphic I got today from Daily Mail miraculous.com, which is a UK paper. They've got better news in the UK than they do in the United States, because ours is just so full of political correctness. It just, you can't get the news, you get the spin. So anyway, I go there, and they have fairly straightforward news. But this is in keeping what's going on here, this Gaza battle and unrest in the Western Bank, and this graphic shows all of these things that are going on. And it's horrendous. If you've ever been under a rocket attack, and I have, I was in Afghanistan for quite some time, and you get shot at, and then you just go, well, hopefully that one doesn't have my name on it, because there's nothing much you can do about it besides hit the dirt and hope it doesn't hit you. So that is the life that they're under right now. And there has been over 3,000 rockets shot at Israel. It's not that the Israelis are bloodthirsty and looking for this conflict. The conflict came to them, and they are just responding. Now, what does the Burdensome Stone Prophecy say? And we'll read it in a bit. It says that anybody that goes up against Israel will be cut to pieces. And that's what we're seeing right now. The Gaza Islamists are being cut to pieces, including their children. And they're going to lose this battle, according to a Zechariah 12 prophecy, 1 through 3 verses. And we'll read it in a bit. But are they going to win the media war? And they have been, for the last 30 years, winning the media war. Because Israel has been vilified. Israel has got a horrible name on an international stage by most of the world. But that's to be expected. Because Israel is the apple of God's eye. So they will get all the attention of Satan, who wants to wipe them out. And I believe a lot of the media is influenced by Satan, because Satan is called the prince of the power of the air. And I think that means in part the airwaves. So he is putting out his media campaign against Israel for a purpose. Now here's where Israel stands down here. This is Israel's Gaza bind. Should they destroy Hamas or wait for the next war? Because that's what happens. Israel beats them down. They get a lot of press. They get what they want. They build up a bunch of rockets and do it all over again. And it's been that cycle for the last 20 years. So what is Israel to do? If you sat there in your town and got shot by, or country, got shot by 3,000 rockets, I saw a Democrat group today said, well, Israel is attacking back too strongly. What would you do if someone's attacking you in your house? Do you they're throwing rocks at you. Do you sit there and say, stop that? No, you're going to do something about it. You're wanting it to stop. So Israel is sitting here going, what should we do now? Should we be on the borders and go in and completely wipe them out? Interestingly enough, they wiped out, like I said earlier, they're wiping out the leadership. That's why they're in no rush to stop right now. They're taking out all the commanders that they can, while they can, by shooting rockets at them. And what do the commanders do? They hide behind children. And that's why that number is so high. And it's so such a heinous act. So you have a party within Israel saying there's no return to the pre-war setup. They want to isolate and destroy Hamas. So this is the opportunity they're looking for. And this is why this is such a dicey thing for Israel to do. Is there a breaking point that they're going to reach media-wise that will take the world down upon them? Well, the world's reacting. You have Biden came to called up Netanyahu and said, wind down the bombardment of Gaza. And, you know, of course, who's he listening to? Tlaib over here, and I don't know if you saw this, she chewed Biden out for 8 minutes up in Detroit at the airport, and he stood there and took it. And then afterward he said, oh, she's an intelligent, smart lady, and you know, I've got to respect her and all this sort of thing. But they've got his ear, and they're driving his policy, and his policy right now is pro-Palestinian. So he is in a position where it's difficult for him because there is an extremely strong Israeli lobby in the United States. So he's going to try to play both ends of this. But the Israelis are not going to listen to him because he does not have Israel's best interest in mind. Netanyahu told him he was determined to continue Gaza operations despite pressure from Biden. So he is looking out for his people. Because again, Israel knows that if you don't take out and care of yourself, someone is, you know, you're trusting someone else to take care of you. And they've got a long history that shows them that they can be put in a precarious position very quickly, even though they feel they are safe. Now, while this is all going, and this I'll do an exact quote because this is a good one from Netanyahu. I am sure that all the enemies around us see how costly it is to attack us, and I am sure they will learn the lesson. So he is playing strong, which they have to do, because if you're weak, you will be rolled over in this part of the world. And again, some of the adversaries of Israel want to destroy them completely off the map. And considering the history of Israel, 6 million Jews killed, massacred, incinerated in the Holocaust in World War II, that is still a very raw thing that lives within them. We must defend ourselves. What's the rest of the world doing? I have here, of course, there's Erdogan Togomarth of Ezekiel 38:39, and he speaks and says, Turkey's anti-Israel obsession reaches new heights. So again, he is one of those players, and he's speaking up. We already know what Iran feels, because they have, the Hamas is one of their proxies. They give them the rocket technology and the rockets that they have to fire. They're the ones that are making them and acquiring them. What's Europe saying? Macron extends support of Israel, urging return to peace. I love that. And he is unwavering in his attachment for Israel's security. So he's the current EU figurehead, and he's speaking out. And as we know, as we studied the ten-toed kingdom that shall rise in the latter days out of the former Roman Empire, which is the EU, he may be, and I think he is, the front runner for the Antichrist. So he is saying return to peace. And I'm saying that the lasting peace will only return when the Prince of Peace makes his enemies his footstool. And that doesn't happen until the end of the 7 year tribulation, when Jesus Christ returns in Revelation chapter 19, verses 11 through 21. Now, according to Zechariah 12, 1 through 8, and we're going to read that prophecy, Israel is going to prevail in this battle. But it's my very humble opinion that the seeds are being sown even further for that Ezekiel 38:39 word. I'll tell you why that is as we go through this prophecy. But someday we will see in Zechariah 12, 1 through 8, the protection will end. Right now, when I hear anyone say that the burdensome stone is Israel, that is true. And the neighbors about them are shaking and quaking with rage and fury. But that period of time at some point will end. You never hear them say that, but we'll discuss it this evening. All right, I call this Beyond the Burdensome Stone Prophecy, Zechariah chapter 12. This is unfolding prophecy as well as pending prophecy. We are living in a time of God's burdensome stone. But as I said, it shall end. Zechariah prophesies 520 to 490 BC. And chapters 12, 13, and 14 of his prophecy, which were sealed for 2,500 years, were dramatically opened in 1948 and are still unfolding today. In fact, they're unfolding this very day in Israel today, as we see the actions of Israel against those who wish to destroy her. Few people in the world know today what we are seeing in Israel is prophetic fulfillment before their very eyes. They're too consumed with what is going on in the world. Satan is providing a lot of shiny objects for them to look at, when this is ground zero of what's going on in prophecy right now. What is going on in God's timeline right now? However, what we are seeing is only the beginning of Zechariah's end time prophecy. Now, we're only going to discuss a small portion of it tonight, but it's the portion that transitions from this time of the burdensome stone to the time in which we will see Israel's heart soften. When we're reading this, this is the Lord God, creator of the universe. And in fact, he tells you that again right up front to just say, listen up. I'm speaking here. This is your creator. This is the God that made you and knitted you in your womb. And I am telling you what will occur. So we've got to keep that in focus when we read this.
The burden of the word of the Lord for Israel, saith the Lord, which stretcheth forth the heavens and layeth the foundation of the earth, and formeth the spirit of man within him. Behold, I will make Jerusalem a cup of trembling unto all the people around about, when they shall be in the siege both against Judah and against Jerusalem. And in that day will I make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people. All that burden themselves with it shall be cut in pieces, though all the people of the earth be gathered together against it.
Okay, there's a lot going on here. I want to break this down real quick. The burden of the word of the Lord of Israel. So this is a burden. It's something God decided, I'm carrying this around. This is mine, and I'm not going to let it go. So this is what I'm carrying, so I will take the load of Israel upon myself. So then he says, I'm Lord God, creator of the universe. Are you listening? And then he said, not only did I do that, but I put the spirit within each and every one of you. He knitted us in our mother's womb. And he put inside each and every one of us our souls. There are no mistakes on the earth. Everyone was put on the earth by God. He nurtures every one of us. He watches every one of us. And he knows us at all times during our entire lives. Even before we were born, we were told he saw us and he knew us. And he knew our name would be written in that Lamb's Book of Life from the foundations of the earth. So this is who's talking here. And it says, behold, I will make a trembling unto all the people around us. And if you look at any of the video that is occurring of the Middle East, the rage of the people that are there, the bloodlust, the hate, the fury. This is the trembling that is talking about. These people cannot control themselves in their anger and rage. Satan loves an empty vessel to fill. And these people are being filled with this spirit that is the dark spirit. They are not the children of light. They are the children of darkness. And you could tell just by the look in them sacrificing their children. We saw that. And the burdensome stone for all people. So the whole world is concerned about this. They're trying to carry this burden. Do you hear peace in Africa? Do you hear peace in Australia? Do you hear peace in here? You hear peace in the Middle East all the time. And that is one of the top things the United Nations talks about. So the whole world is watching what's going on in the Middle East right now. And it's a burden that shall cut them to pieces. I will say, though all the people of the earth be gathered together against it, this does not necessarily mean all the armies of the world is gathered against it. This could be all the desires of the world to destroy Israel, and that's exactly what I think it is, because not all the armies of the world are going together against it. That happens at the end of the 7-year tribulation, where the entire earth, but there is a group of nations that shall gather against it. But this is just saying, God is going to protect Israel regardless of who is against him at this period of time. All right, so now let's read 4 through 6, please.
In that day, saith the Lord, I will smite every horse with astonishment and his rider with madness. And I will open mine eyes upon the house of Judah and will smite every horse of the people with blindness. And the governors of Judah shall say in their heart, the inhabitants of Jerusalem shall be my strength. Lord of the hosts, their God. In that day I will make the governors of Judah like heaven, like hearth of fire among the wood, and like a torch of fire a sheep. And they shall devour all the people round about, on the right hand and on the left. And Jerusalem's dead shall be, and have founded again in her own place, even in Jerusalem.
A couple of interesting things I want to bring up here. Notice that we've not talked anything about the spiritual nature of Israel at this point. We're just talking about the physical location of Israel. And it talks about the governors, and it talks about defending them. It talks about there is a like a fire of a sheaf. They're going to devour all the people around her. And we're going to see that happen. I'll show you some graphics on that. Whether they're on the right hand or the left hand, and Jerusalem shall be inhabited again in her own place, even in Jerusalem. That's a fantastic statement right there, because we know that for, I think it's 1,878 years, Israel was not a nation. Jerusalem was destroyed as the nation, and the temple was destroyed in 70 AD. And we'll get on to that in a minute, but just, that's what it said. It's a pretty amazing piece of prophecy, because this can only happen when Jerusalem shall be inhabited again in her own place, even in Jerusalem. So it's giving you a time frame there. And then it talks about the glory of the house of David, and the inhabitants of Jerusalem do magnify themselves against Judah. So I don't think we read 7. Someone read 7 and 8. You don't want to fight Israel at this time, because God is there with you. God is strengthening. And I love this line. Even the most feeble among them at that day shall be as David. And who was David? King David was the mightiest warrior, the mightiest king that the people of Israel has ever seen. So it is talking about the strength of Israel. That is an odd thing to read if you're not in the current time that we live in. Because Israel was not always that way. And I will talk about where we are at prophetically. I've highlighted in yellow here a number of things. You can see Zechariah over here. Let me enlarge this here. Right here is the time frame we're talking about. Everyone see Zechariah 12? That's where it falls. Where does it fall? Well, it falls after 1948 AD when Israel was born. Now, you can argue they were there a few years before, but without a doubt, when Israel was formed as a nation in 1948, this prophecy held true. We'll also see that mention of the Ezekiel war, and I'll include that. We'll also talk a little bit about the rapture, where it falls, and why that is important, and we can kind of see that in this prophecy. And we'll, of course, talk about Daniel 9:27. And Zechariah 12 spans that period of time. So I'll tie all of that in together, aware of this timeline, and kind of sees where we're at. Because it's critical for us to know this piece of prophecy and where it falls within the timeline of God. This is when this prophecy came in full bloom. Without a doubt, 14 May 1948. This is the greatest prophetic event that has occurred in the Bible since 70 AD, when Jerusalem was destroyed by Titus, General Titus, the son of the Emperor Vespasian. And it was destroyed. And none of this prophecy that we're looking at today was even possible. Okay, remember when we said back in the, I think it's the 7th verse of Zechariah, where it says, and Israel will be, or Jerusalem will be inhabited again. And it is. This prophecy could not have happened before 1948. It laid dormant for, I got it right, 1,878 years. This prophecy couldn't be true. But it is true now. And all these different prophecies just sprung into being and came into place because it was God's time for this to occur. So, that's when Zechariah 12, 1 through 3 occurred. Because as soon as she was announced as a nation, the Muslim nations around her attacked her. And she had to fight for her life from the beginning. And guess what? Anybody that came up against her was what? Broken into pieces, was defeated. The prophecy was fulfilled on those first few days that Israel was a nation. And has it ceased? Absolutely not. We see it over and over and over again, where Israel had to defend itself as a country. We saw in 48, 49, there was war. In 67, there was war. There has been wars and conflict in that region. She defeated, as the prophecy said, those to the left and those to the right. None were able to defeat Israel. In 1967, Jerusalem under the Jewish control for the first time since 70 AD. Just think how amazing that is. There is no parallel in history that compares with the rebirth of Israel. No nation has ever been utterly destroyed, scattered over the face of the earth, and reformed as a nation. But not only did Israel do this, it was able to recapture its capital. And all of this was written in the Bible as prophecy. That is just amazing. And that is the hand of God. And that is what we hear in our read in Zechariah 12, 1 through 3. God is the reason that this is occurring. Now, it's even more amazing when you consider this is not the first time this happened in 1948. Remember, King Nebuchadnezzar destroyed the Jewish kingdom of Judah, destroyed Jerusalem, destroyed the temple. They were totally wiped out and moved out as a nation. And 70 years later, they reformed, moved back, and became a nation again. Why? God's hand was involved. So this nation has been blessed by God. It is the apple of God's eye. God, likely via the archangel Michael, protected Israel as she defeated the combined Arab forces engaged by Satan in the first Arab-Israeli war in 48, the Suez War in 56, the Six Days War in 67, and the Yom Kippur War of 73. During the Yom Kippur War, Soviet and U.S. forces reached the highest level of nuclear alert, but God calmed the storm. Zechariah 12, 1 through 3, was in effect during this entire period of time. And down here, I like the... Didn't this look like the old Brenner with an eye patch? Moshe Dayan? I mean, yeah. Yeah, I always thought he had a cool picture. We know the burdensome stone. We know it's in effect right now. We know that Israel will not be destroyed right now. We know that they will cut their enemies to pieces. But when will that be over? We know it's going to end at some time. Jesus is referenced this time in the Olivet Discourse, and that's what we're going to look at now. When and what shall the time of the burdensome stone? When is that? Now, Jesus is going to tell us exactly what is going to occur and what he's going to confirm what we just read in Zechariah. He's going to confirm this time. So I'd like for someone, next reader, to read this passage right here from Matthew 24 through 32 all the way to 36. And understand that this is also in the Synoptic Gospels, and it's also found in Mark 13, 28 and Luke 21, 29. Again, this is critical for our understanding of what's going on, and I will discuss this afterward.
All right, thank you. And learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, ye know that the summer is nigh. So likewise, ye shall see these things, know that it is near, even at the door. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass, till all these things be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only.
Now, if you go back and look before Matthew 24, 32, that's the Olivet Discourse, and Jesus is talking about all the things that would occur. And he puts a time frame on those horrible things that would have happened to the Jewish people. In that time frame, he's giving this period of time as a marker. It says, the parable of fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and put forth leaves, ye know the summer is nigh. Now, what's that mean? Well, if you go back, if you remember in the scripture, it talks about a fig tree. And Jesus said that, look, it is bearing no fruit. And he has it, and it withers just like that and dries up. He's talking about Israel bearing no fruit because they were rejected, and he knew that. So we know this is the parable of the fig tree is what he's talking about. But this fig tree is reborn in when? 1948. And when his branch is yet tender. So that means when Israel is born again as a nation and tender, it shall put forth leaves. You know the summer is nigh. So what does that mean? If we look out here, we see here is Israel reborn as a nation right here. We see it puts out shoots early on. Not even, 20 years old yet, and it has gained this territory in the West Bank. It has gained the Gaza Strip. It has gained the Sinai Peninsula. So it has put out those shoots. Now, it has retained that land again, as we just saw in the prophecy of Zechariah 1 through 8 that shows us that. So this is exactly the time frame God is telling us about, and it's just, Jesus is telling about it, it's just confirmation. So, likewise, when you see all these things, and we have seen Israel form again as a nation, the fig tree, and we have seen it put out its tender shoots in this, highly contested land, this West Bank and the Gaza Strip area, all this has happened. And then it says, verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass. Now, you'll get some people that they're not very knowledgeable at the Bible. They say, oh, that means it should have, a generation should have passed after Jesus did all this. Well, they don't understand the prophecy. The prophecy is when that fig tree is tender shooted again, which is 1948, and shoots forth into this other areas, 67, then a generation shall not pass. It shall see all these things be fulfilled. You're living under this right now. You're living under this prophecy of Jesus Christ. Right now, you are that generation. Till all these things be fulfilled, heaven and earth shall not pass away, but my words shall not pass away. But of the day and the hour, no man knoweth. And I put this in here because woe unto the date setters. No one's going to be able to know the day or the hour. But we are not going to be kept in the dark. Jesus Christ wants us to understand the signs of the times, and he's given to us right now what those are. And I say Israel is the fig tree. And you'll find that in Mark 11, 13 through 14. It's just what I told, the story I told you. This verse correlates to this time of the burdensome stone. After the time of Jesus Christ, the Roman Empire occupied Israel and then destroyed her in 70 AD. But Israel was reborn in 1948 and has since expanded her territory in conflict. That is fascinating because how does God let you know he is God? He tells you what's going to happen in the future, and then it is fulfilled, as he said. So how long is a generation is the question that always comes up. Well, if you look into the Bible, you'll see this. There's a different reference earlier about 120 years, but it's superseded by Psalms 90:10. It says, the days of our years are 70 years and 10, and if by reason of strength, they will be 80 years. Now, I'm not a date setter, but that's 70 or 80 years. And if you use 1948, those years are between 2018 and 2020. Or if you use 67, it's 2037 to 2047. So, what is it going to be? I don't know. But if we're living in that generation, it could be right around the corner. We're already within the window of 1948. So, what will it be? I don't know. But I'm just putting that, I'm not a date setter, I'm just putting that on there to show you what many Bible scholars believe this is pointed to. Any questions before we move on?
Did you explain what the burdensome stone is?
Yes, I'll go back. Let's see here. The burdensome stone is Jerusalem. Now, what it means is, if you look up the word, it means a burden, something you carry around. Here, the burden of the word of the Lord is Israel. God is carrying around Israel. Just like you saw the tracks in the sand when Jesus Christ, you know, they said, where were you, Jesus? When I was going through the sands, I only see one pair of footprints. And then Jesus says back to them, and this is just a story, not the Bible, I carried you. Well, here, God is carrying Israel through this period of time. No one will be able to come against them. And they're a burdensome stone. The burden that God is carrying around is Israel. But this burden is a lot of people are going to carry this around. Israel is going to get inside the head of all kinds of people. And they will be furious, this cup of trembling of people that are around them. And they are a burdensome stone for all of these people because they can't set it down. They can't leave it alone. They must contend with it. Israel is the burdensome stone, and it will continue to be the burdensome stone that everyone that comes up against it shall be cut to pieces. But that will change. So what shall conclude the burdensome stone era? God destroying those specific nations that come against Israel. The reason I say that is because that is the next thing that occurs in Zechariah. You have this period of time where God is carrying the burden of Israel and he's defending them. And then we have this verse that occurs in Zechariah 12:9 after Zechariah 12:1-8. There's something that changes here. In Zechariah 12:9, I'll read this, and it shall come to pass in that day that I will seek to destroy all the nations that have come against Israel. Now, to this day, none of the nations that have come against Israel from 1948 until the present day have been destroyed. He has let Israel win, but those nations still exist as nations. But here it says, I will seek to destroy all the nations that come against thee. Now, during the 7-year tribulation, we know that something will change. We know that Israel will not be this burdensome stone that no one can beat, that everyone's cut up against, because the Antichrist will be in charge of the entire world. Now, you can go to Revelation 13, it says exactly that. We must understand that at some point in the future, Israel will not be able to defeat the Antichrist. So right now, right there, the beast is in charge of the whole world. And it also says up here in 4, and they worship the dragon which gave power to the beast, and they worship the beast saying, who like is like the beast? Who can make war? So with all this in 13, you have the Antichrist will be in charge of the entire earth. And at that point, Israel will not be able to cut every enemy up to pieces. So something changes between this time that God is carrying the burden of Israel and defending her. Then he's destroying these nations. And then all of a sudden, Israel is under a different regime for leadership. And God backs away. Now, when does that happen? And that's what we have to ask ourselves. All right, so during the 7-year tribulation, all of the world, including Jerusalem, is under the Antichrist control. In my very humble opinion, the conflict in the verse, in this verse here, Zechariah 12:9, directly points to the Ezekiel 38:9 war, which ushers in the Jews into a new relationship, a new era with God. So we have a sea change coming. And that is what this is referring to. And we will see that also in the verse that follows. Now, I do like the King James Bible in this respect because it's showing you here that there's a paragraph change. Whoever wrote the text originally wrote 12:1-8, and then they switched, and we're in a new paragraph now. So, in that day, and it's talking about in this era of time, shall come to pass that I will seek to destroy all the nations that come against Jerusalem. And who are those nations? So let the next reader read this, Ezekiel 38:1-3, and then we'll go 4-6.
Therefore, thou son of man, prophesy against Gog and say, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I am against thee, O Gog, Abiathar, the chief priests of Meshach and Tubal, and I will turn thee back and leave thee, and leave but the sixth part of thee, and will cause thee to come up from the north parts, and will bring thee upon the mountains of Israel. And I will smite thy bow out of thy left hand, and will cause thine arrows to fall out of thy right hand.
4-6, please.
You shall fall upon the mountains of Israel, you and all your troops, and the peoples who are with you. I will give you to birds of prey of every sort, and to the beasts of the field to be devoured. You shall fall on the open field, for I have spoken, says the Lord God. And I will send fire on Magog and on those who live in security in the coastland. Then they shall know that I am the Lord.
So here we have Ezekiel 39:1. It's interesting that in Ezekiel 37, that is the valley of the dry bones that God is going to put flesh on, which equates to 1948 and the rebirth of Israel. Then you have 38 and 39 in Ezekiel, which discusses this Gog-Magog war. And I think we see direct corollaries here. Destroy all the nations that come against thee. The next nations that come against thee in the Bible, Jerusalem, are these nations that are portrayed in Ezekiel 38 and 39. And he will destroy them. He will destroy not only the army, he will destroy 5/6 of the army, but he is also going to destroy the nation of Magog. And that doesn't mean everyone that lives there. That could just mean the capital city, the ruling class that's there. And he could destroy them and send fire upon them, and also them that dwell in the isles. And that often meant nations that were far off, set on different shores. So who is ever coming with Magog, hellfire and brimstone will fall upon their nations, and they will be destroyed. This is God speaking again. So going back up here, we see how this falls in here. We have this Zechariah prophecy, and the only unfulfilled huge war that it's talking about is right here. And here's Zechariah, and this falls in line with what has prophetically yet to be fulfilled. So you have this great war, and so it's, again, what it talks about, you have a period where God will protect, then you have a God that is going to destroy nations. I've given a class on this in February 2020. It talks about the nations aligned with Ezekiel's geography. This is exactly what it is said in the Bible. Not necessarily these nations, but this is an indicator of where the nations could come from. There's no debate about Persia being Iran. It says in the Bible, the house of Togarmah on the north quarters and all the bands and many people thereof. If you draw a line from Jerusalem, straight north, you hit Turkey, you hit Moscow, and those nations are going to come down out of the north quarters. Many scholars debate the location of ancient nations in Ezekiel, but if you draw that line north, there's no doubt about who is north of Israel. All these nations are also now currently aligned geopolitically against Israel. So go for the full study and look there. So what happens next? What follows this Zechariah 12:9 war? To find that, we look again in Ezekiel and we see what it says immediately after those verses that we just read. Please read Ezekiel 39:7.
So will I make my holy name known in the midst of my people Israel, and I will not let them pollute my holy name anymore. And the heathen shall know that I am the Lord, the Holy One in Israel.
God steps forth from the shadows. Now, of course, we know God is there all the time. But the Gentile God-denying world does not see the God of miracles, power, and justice that we do. They don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and they don't humble themselves before God and acknowledge Him. But God is going to step forth from the shadows, and He's going to miraculously save Israel, because Israel has a strong army, but its strong army will not be able to stand against these nations coming down for some reason. So God will step in and destroy them before they even show up. And it's fascinating read. And that's what it says right here. I will turn thee back and leave but six part of thee, and to come to the north parts. I will bring thee upon the mountains of Israel, and I will smite thy bow in the left hand and cause arrows to fall out of thy hands. Thou shalt fall on the mountains of Israel. And this is God that is going to do this. Israel is going to step back and not have to do anything. And they will all acknowledge that there is a supernatural event that occurred. Now, many spiritually awed Jews will for the first time realize that the God of the Bible is God. And they will want to worship the Old Testament God in that third temple. We discussed that last week. But rather than trust in God to defend them, and this is amazing to me, they will sign at this time a mutual defense pact with many heathen nations, and those heathen nations will be led by the Antichrist. Why do we know that? That's exactly what it says will occur in Daniel 9:27. It says, he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. Now I believe, in my humble opinion, something supernatural will have to occur for to have the Muslim nations we see right now willing to come to the table and sign this peace treaty. You will have the most anti-Israel radical nations humbled during this Ezekiel 38 and 39 war. Some of them will be destroyed. Their armies will be dissipated. They will be weakened. What you will have left, and the Shiite nations are for the most part against them, against Israel. You'll have the more moderate Sunni nations left, and they will probably sign this treaty. And the reason many in Israel, and it says many for 1 week, the reason many in Israel will sign it is because they want that Temple Mount temple. They are willing to give up, whatever it is, the defense of God, because God is going to take this personal, and he is going to back off his hand if they sign this treaty. And this is what this treaty is called by Isaiah 28:15. Because you have said, we have made a covenant with death, and with hell are we at agreement. When the overflowing scourge shall pass through it, that you, it shall not come upon us. That's Israel talking. When the scourge comes, it will not bother us, for we have made lies our refuge and are under falsehoods have we hid ourselves. They think they're under the protection of the one who signs this treaty. This treaty with death and hell is what it's called. And go in there and I read Isaiah 28:15 through 18, and you'll see that it echoes this time specifically. So here we have the treaty. Here we have what God thinks of this, because of this, he's going to back off this burdensome stone, and he is going to let the Antichrist defend this nation. And that is phenomenal to think about. No longer is God carrying the burden of his Israel, the land of Israel, the nation of Israel. He is setting down that burden, and he is picking up another burden, which is fantastic, and we'll see that in a minute. This signature of the 7-year covenant starts the 7-year tribulation as Jesus Christ opens that seven seal scroll in chapter 6. Now, that is a fantastic piece of prophecy. The Lamb of God is opening up that seven sealed scroll. And in Revelation 6:2, it says the following. Just after it says Jesus Christ opened the seal, this is what it starts with. Revelation 6:2. And I saw and beheld a white horse. Now, this isn't the white horse we see in Revelations 19, 11 through 21. Jesus Christ rides a white horse, doesn't he? This is the false Christ riding this horse. This is the pseudo, our fake, our replacement Antichrist on this horse. And he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him. And he went forth conquering and to conquer. So all of a sudden we see The Antichrist signed this treaty with Israel. God does not like this treaty that the people of Israel have signed with the Antichrist. And they have the book of Isaiah in their hands. They have the book of Daniel in their Torah. They should know these things. But they're not ignoring, they're not seeing these things and they're ignoring them. We can sit here and read these today and know what they are because we have Jesus Christ who gives us the center of our understanding of biblical knowledge. And that's what this is leading to. Jesus Christ is leading the people of Israel to himself. And this is the method in which he's choosing to do so. So again, the Antichrist is going to be released. And who is he? If you go there and read, that's a good name for him. He is an overflowing scourge. If you read Revelation 6, 3 onward, you are going to see the four horsemen of the apocalypse ride. And the Antichrist will be in charge of that period of time. And he will subdue the rest of the world as the 10 kings of the earth stand up for him. And as he takes control. Now again, this is forming. So, what do we know thus far? We know that after the Ezekiel 38-39 war, it's going to be a tremendous spiritual awakening in Israel. They're going to want to worship the God that they saw. The Gentile world will be humbled and they will acknowledge that Israel has a special connection with God and they'll want to sign the treaty. And the Antichrist will stand up and say, I will help guarantee Israel has safety and has peace. And because Israel signed, or I should say many of the Jews signed that, God is going to let them go down the path they want. Just like any of us, when we choose sin in our lives, God will let us go down that path of sin. But there is a price to pay. So the next thing that occurs is the signature on this treaty coincides with the opening of the seventh seal scroll because Daniel in verse 9:27 says that is exactly what occurs. So this is all in line with scripture. Now, what follows in Zechariah 12:9, the war that occurs? Again, we saw, it sounded to me, and I believe this wholeheartedly, it shall come to pass in that day that I will seek to destroy all the nations that come against Jerusalem. And all the nations that come is, again, like I said, Ezekiel 38 and 39. So what does the next verse say? What follows Zechariah 12:9? Immediately after Ezekiel 38 and 39 war, during the early part of the 7-year tribulation, there will be two spiritual awakenings in Israel. While many Jews will want to return to temple worship, many Jews' hearts will respond to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, I don't know how that's going to happen, but God is going to allow that to start happening to the Jews. Now, we know this from Revelation chapter 7, and I want someone to cue up Romans 11:25. Who's the second reader? The next reader, I would like for you to read Revelation 7:4 and 7:10 here in green. So here we just talked about Revelation chapter 6, in which many hell breaks loose. And the reason I say it like that is hell on earth for sure breaks loose in the last 3.5 years. But this will be a mini hell on earth when that false white horse charges out with the four horses of the apocalypse and those run across the face of the earth. Immediately after that, we have chapter 7. And chapter 7 discusses the reawakening of the Jewish people. I have heard the number, and we've all seen this 144,000, from every tribe that is in Israel at the time. And if you ask an Israeli person, they know what tribe they're in. They know their ancestry. They know where they came from. So here you have 144,000, 12,000 coming from each one of the 12 tribes. God already knows who those people are. God is nurturing and raising up those people for this moment, because this 144,000 seal will be spread out and scattered out over the face of the earth and bring the gospel to the people. Now, we do not know for sure how God is going to pour himself out. But look at this very next verse after Zechariah 12:9. We will see this wonderful parallel about the spiritual awakening that will occur during this time. So if I could have somebody read Zechariah 10 and 11.
Pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplications. And they shall look upon me whom they have pierced, and they shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn. On that day of weeping in Jerusalem will be great, like the weeping of Hadad Rimon in the plain of Midgar.
All right. Now, who's that one that was pierced?
Jesus
Christ, without a doubt. Without a doubt. Now, we'll turn to the Bible and we'll see the remainder of Zechariah there.
And the land shall mourn, every family apart, the family of the house of David apart, and their wives apart, the family of the house of Nathan apart, and their wives apart, the family of the house of Levi apart, and their wives apart, the family of Shimei apart, and their wives apart, all the families that remain, every family apart, and their wives apart.
So, all of these tribes are affected by this. So here we see a reference back to where we're seeing in Revelation chapter 7, where it talks about each and every tribe, 144,000. So there will be a remnant God has within Israel at this time that hearts are awakened in. Isn't that amazing to consider? That God will have this in the midst of the burdensome stone being gone. He had protected them to nurture Israel to the point they needed to be to bring them to the place where they had to be totally saved by God, and then he's going to remove himself from the protection of them and move to the spiritual protection of the people. So it's pretty interesting that he'll go from I'm protecting you physically to I'm protecting this remnant of people. Now, the way the rapture moves into this is we're going to look, I had asked somebody to look up Romans 11, 25. And this is where the rapture coincides with this period of time. It's an amazing verse, and we should all know it. If someone wants to read that, it's 11:25. I got it right at the top. Someone got that?
For I would not will that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own conceit. The blindness in part is happening to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in.
The fullness of the Gentiles. Now, we're not talking, this is not to be confused with the Gentiles trotting down. This is a different thing. This is the fullness of the Gentiles. Become into what? Become into the church. When the fullness of the Gentiles completes within the church, that is when the hardening of Israel, that partial blindness that is happening, will end. So you have the church that discussed here. After the church is lifted up, and we'll go back and look at the reference to this, Zechariah 12, Ezekiel 38 and 39 just occurred. And then we will see this covenant made, Daniel 9:27 in the yellow up here at the top. That's when that covenant is made. And then we see back down here in Zechariah 12, that it will span across there. The church is raptured up. After the church is raptured up, and we don't know whether it's going to happen, the rapture of the church will happen before Ezekiel 38 and 39 or after, but it's somewhere in that time frame. Because after the church is up and lifted out, that fullness of the Gentiles occurs. And we don't know when that is. Only the Father in the heaven knows when the last soul in the church could come in. Now, it might be a baby that's aborted. Sad to think about, but that baby's soul is precious to God, and if it gets aborted, that might be the last soul that enters in. Or it might be somebody that you've talked to about Jesus Christ that comes to a saving relationship with Jesus Christ, and that might be the last soul that enters into the church. But there is going to be a last soul, and when that happens, God will lift up the church in the rapture, and that church will be with him in heaven in those many mansions that is talked about. At that time, that is when Israel, hardening of the heart, will end, which coincides with what we see in Zechariah 12:10, where God pours out his spirit upon them and they again can develop that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. They will look upon the one that they have pierced and realize that, my God, how have I not seen all these things that have occurred? My God, why didn't I see the gospel and know that Jesus Christ was the Messiah? The Messiah that the Jews have been looking for 2,000 years was Jesus Christ all along. That will come to their awareness during this time. And this time that I'm talking about is this 70th week. And again, it all starts when we have that covenant with hell and death that occurs. God will remove that hand. They will no longer be a burden that he physically holds right now. He will allow them to go their way. If they wanted to go with the Antichrist offering peace and safety, God will let them. But he will save a remnant. And the reason we know that as well is because in Zechariah, in the next chapters, we'll move over and we will see that not everyone is going to be saved. I know right there in Romans 11, verse 26 says, all Israel shall be saved. But Zechariah says that all Israel might be a different definition. Let's go to 13. And I will show you the number in the house of Israel that will be saved. And this verse right here, and again, we're walking through. If you look at 13, you'll see that the Holy Spirit is poured out upon these people. They will want to get rid of the idols in their land. They will, you know, turn away from the prophecy of their fathers, and they will still turn to the gospel. Wake, O sword, against my shepherd and against the man that is my fellow, saith the Lord of hosts. Smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered. Now, this is not talking about Jesus Christ. This is talking about those who follow Jesus Christ, and they will be scattered upon the face of the earth, and he will turn his hands to the little ones there. And because this is the time of Israel, listen to what it says. And it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die, but a third shall be left therein. Only one third of the Jews at this time, during this revelation, 7 year tribulation period, will survive. And look at what it says to him. I will bring the third part through the fire, and will refine them as silver is refined, and will try them as gold is tried. For they shall call upon my name, and I will hear them, and I will say, it is my people, and they shall say, the Lord is my God. This is discussing the nation of Israel in these latter days, in which there will be this revival within Israel to recognize Jesus as the Messiah. And this is what it is speaking of, when the burdensome stone shall no longer be, because God is turning to the hearts of the people and saving those people at this time. We see that God is in complete control. We know that he is protecting Israel right now, and everyone that goes up against her shall be cut to pieces. But that will end. That will end as we transition from this time of protection to a time of destruction for those that came up against them. And then we're going to move into that 7-year tribulation period. And during that time, Israel will be defended by the Antichrist. And God will let him do that for that 7-year period of time. In the middle of that 7-year period of time, you know, Antichrist is going to look like their best friend up until the midway in the tribulation, when he declares himself God over all mankind. And then that's when Israel is supposed to flee to the mountains of Judea. Who will flee? Those that are in relationship with Jesus Christ and acknowledge him as the Messiah. So we know that this Zechariah 12, 1 through 8 prophecy will end when it is time for God to deal with the Jews on a heart-to-heart basis. Do we have any questions?
Enlightening. Good.
And it shows the relationships we need to understand. Because the world right now looks in confusion if you don't have the Bible in your hands. How can the world resolve what is going on in the Middle East? The answer to that is they can't. They won't. Only God will come back and bring the peace to Jerusalem. He alone. Mankind cannot, but they will try. So, who do we trust in?
God.
Jesus Christ, God. We do that both personally as well as collectively as a nation. We need to trust in God.
Somebody going through life that doesn't have that belief, with as bad as everything is now, make sense of it.
Yeah, well, there is such...
You're trying to make sense of it. I mean,
right. We are so blessed right now to be able to have the Word of God in our hands and to be able to live in this country. This United States is a unique bubble in history where we have religious freedom to worship the way we want to. Not all nations have that. We have the Bible. We were blessed with that. God is going to have to deal with every soul in mankind. Satan has been oppressing complete parts of the world, and they are in darkness right now. Now, all those individuals, I know people have said to me before, well, how will God ever judge those people that have never heard the name of Jesus Christ? And I say, God will judge them righteously. You do not want any other God than Jesus Christ judging you. Because Jesus Christ alone can look into the depths of the heart and he can see who you are down to the core. No one else can do that. He is the only righteous judge. So, you know, we as Christians are going to end up at the bema seat of Christ. And because we are covered with the blood of Jesus Christ, it will cover all our unrighteousness. Because he alone is righteousness. Though our sins will be as scarlet, they will be as white as snow, and we will wear those linen robes, and we will get to commune with God on a spiritual level like we've never had before. And I so look forward to that moment, to shed this flesh that is so distracting, that is so annoying at times. I look forward to that new body, and where we can really commune with God in the manner that he intended us, because we'll be in our new bodies, we'll be in our new homes. We will not be tempted of the flesh like everyone else in the world is. But we will have that anew. Does that have a question? Anyone have a... But this is a special time, and I think there's so many people that do not understand what this transition is going to be like. They think that Israel will go on and continuing, you know, to defeat all her enemies. She won't. She'll be defeated. She'll be defeated and she'll be trodden to the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles is complete. Not the number, fullness of the Gentiles, which again is the church. So, what else? Yeah, there's just so many gems in the Bible. And it is so interwoven and is so supporting. If you study the Bible, if you take the time, you will see that only God can have woven this thing together. I mean, the threads are just too improbable to just exist because some smart guys made this stuff up. No, it was written over 1,600 years by 40 different authors. And when you read it, the threads just intertwine throughout, supporting each other if you take the time to look.
I guess the news kind of helps direct you.
Yes, well.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, and that's what it is. What happens after the burdensome stone is a big question. What happens? Well, the scripture says the following. And I think it's fairly, you know, if you read Zechariah, this is where it points to. We have a period of protection, we have a period of where he attacks, God does, and we have a period of spiritual renewal that occurs. Some people say, well, that's all millennial kingdom. No, I think it's all pretty much, you know, written. Ezekiel, if you read, and I'd ask you to go read Zechariah 12 through 14, and it's a mini end times scenario going on. You have in the middle, and I'll just... You have in the beginning in which God protects in 1948 to current, and then we move into, you know, that battle, that singular battle in verse 9. Then we move into God is going to wake up Israel. And then after that, it moves into more of that waking up of Israel. Then it moves into only one third of the Jews are going to survive. And then it moves right into God's going to come back and destroy at the end of, you know, the Revelation period, in which he comes back as the white horse. And then it's all sequential. And it backs up what Ezekiel is saying. So it kind of fits and fills in the gaps as best we can with the scripture. So it's pretty fascinating. I'd ask you to read that. And if you ever have any questions, please shoot me an email. Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we are amazed by you. We just feel so humbled to be called your children, to be grafted into the vine, where we can spiritually feel your presence in our midst. You are indwelling us. You are giving us the sustaining power that allows us to go through the troubles in life, to go through these things that are occurring on the earth, understanding, Lord, that you have overcome all this. And because you can overcome, we through you can overcome anything that is around us. There is no pit so deep that you can't pull us from there. There's no wound so grievous upon us that you can't heal us of spiritually. Lord, we put ourselves in your hands. We rest in your bosom, knowing that you've got this. You love us, and your grace covers us. So Jesus Christ, we pray that you will be with us this week until we see each other again and commune together in the body of Christ. Lord, what a reassurance we have, knowing that you are a loving God, the living God, and that you are with us from now to the end of eternity. In the name of Jesus Christ, the author of our salvation, we pray. Amen.